Good morning. We welcome our worshipers, those who will be watching this service later online, to worship this morning. We welcome you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to worship. We pray that you will be nurtured today, that you will experience the community of First United Methodist Church, and that you will feel, if you're visiting today, that you are made to feel welcome and at home in the Lord. I would like to thank Vicar Derek for the invitation to preach today. You can assess that at the end of the service. If I may, for a moment, I want to say something about how resilient our congregations are who have gone through a number of changes in the last few years. If any two churches in the United Methodist Church should have PTSD, it's Christ and First United Methodist Churches in Ashland. We have had a rotation of pastors, and that's something that happens in the United Methodist Church, usually not with the frequency that we've experienced. But one of the things that I trust in all of this is that God has our best interests in mind with the persons called to serve, to minister, to bring God's word to us. So I am thankful, as Dag Hammarskjöld, the great statesman, he was the Secretary General of the United Nations back in the 50s and early 60s, said in his remarkable book, Markings. He said, "For all that is past, thanks. For all that is to be, yes." So we are in that yes right now, and I invite you to worship God. I want to thank you for all the people who contributed to the renovation of the pipe organ, which you will hear for the first time in its renovated state today. So for all the people that made that possible, and through the Ashland County Community Foundation, we want to thank them for this important part of our worship experience. I'd like to draw your attention to the announcements on the back of your order of service today. The Breakfast Club Sunday School class is concluding its study of the book Rembrandt in the Wind, which is about art, faith, history of art, and how that nurtures our spirits, and you're invited to that. And you're invited to come to that in room number whatever it is upstairs. You'll find us. I've been here for a long time, and I'm still working on the room numbers. So, let us worship God.
Thank you. I am. Oh, how grateful I am to you, Lord, because you are so
Please stand as you are able. May the grace of Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
O God, in mystery and silence, you are present in our lives, bringing new life out of destruction, hope out of despair, growth out of difficulty. We thank you that you do not leave us alone, but labor to make us whole. Help us to perceive your unseen hand in the unfolding of our lives, and to attend in the gentle guidance of your Spirit, that we may know the joy you give your people. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated.
Seeking hope.
be seated. Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Let us continue in prayer. O God, invite us to a deep attentiveness, to listen and inspire in us a holy zeal, to respond as we hear your Spirit-drenched word reread and interpreted today. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In our first reading, Paul reminds us, Timothy, of the dangers of faithfulness, but affirms that God always remains faithful. He then urges Timothy to present himself as one who knows correctly who to teach God's word of truth. In this, Timothy remains strong in the faith while strengthening others. A reading from 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 8 through 15. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Never forget that Jesus Christ was a man born into King David's family and that he was raised from the dead. This is the good news I preach. And because I preach this good news, I am suffering and have been chained like a criminal. But the word of God cannot be chained. I am willing to endure anything if it will bring salvation and eternal glory in Christ Jesus. To those God has chosen, this is a true saying. If we die with him, we will also live with him. If we endure hardship, we will reign with him. If we deny him, he will deny us. If we are unfaithful, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Remind everyone these things and command them in God's name to stop fighting over words. Such arguments are useless, and they can ruin those who hear them. Work hard so God can approve you. Be a good worker, one who does not need to be ashamed and who correctly explains the word of truth. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Sight and song and good deeds done for faith and family.
loving friends, for the day that begins and the night that ends. Ten unclean and nowhere to go, ten men cleansed as clean as snow. One return to give God thanks, but nine went away.
I invite you to stand as you are able to hear the Holy Gospel. The gospel for today is written in Luke, the 17th chapter, the 11th through the 19th verses. This is the story we just heard sung. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him, keeping their distance. They called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return to give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." This is the gospel of the Lord. Please. I had a little bit of a surprise today. I didn't know that part of my family was going to be here. So I welcome 2 sons and 2 grandkids. That was a surprise. Our son Andy was baptized right here in 1976. This church has been woven through our lives. I was privileged to serve here as the associate from 1973 to 1977, and I know to some of you that will be ancient history. In the 18 years that we were away, we kept in touch with several families, the Weavers, Sue and Bob Gregg, Joyce and Nevin Bowers, Dave and Sandy Grindle of blessed memory. So the ties to this church have extended over the years. After we moved away, Gene and Doug Dirks and their tribe came to visit us one Sunday. I still remember that, out in the country in Portage County. So our ties to this church were renewed in some ways when we moved back to Ashland in 1995. And even though I was serving another church, friendships were renewed. I had occasions to work with the pastors. When Pastor Dan Bilkert was here, I covered for him for a number of weeks while he was on a renewal leave. So the renewal of those ties were very nurturing to my spirit. And then when our churches worked toward merger and that failed, and I know there's still some sore spots about that, it put me in a rather awkward position, because when the churches were yoked together, I was on the church staff as pastor of visitation, and after they split apart, then I was on 2 churches' staff as pastor of visitation. So right now, I kind of have a foot here and a foot in Christ Church, both. But as I look out on this congregation and the folks that have come over the years since I was here as a part of the staff, I remember how nurturing I have always been here, nurtured by this congregation, and the deep, deep commitments you have to one another, to community, and to spreading the gospel of Jesus in very tangible ways. I want to also say something about the music program here. And again, thank you to the people who helped sponsor the renovation of the pipe organ. You know, in some circles, that's perceived to be a very archaic, not very useful instrument, until you hear it. And then somehow it connects here. So thank you, Sue, for your artistry. And Sue, I came here 49 years ago, July 1st. Sue came here 49 years ago, September 1st. So this is her 49th year as your organist. And just one last thing I want to say. Well, it's not the last thing, and I don't want you to be alarmed, but I haven't even started the sermon yet. I want to thank Caroline, Grace, and Ryan. They were the entertainment at our East Ohio Conference retirees luncheon on Thursday, and you did us proud. So thank you for your ministry. I like to call that assembly the Geezer Fest. And I want to thank Justin, who's confirmed here in May on Pentecost, and this is his maiden voyage as our reader. So thank you, Justin. Thank you. And now this really is the last thing before the sermon, and I want to thank Tony McKee, our deacon in residence, who I had the privilege of performing your wedding service a number of years ago. And Tony has been a good friend and colleague for many years, and I want to thank God. One of Tony's claims to fame was at annual conference for many years, she led the conference vacation Bible school, which didn't have a few kids, it had many, many kids. And one of the highlights of annual conference was when Tony brought all the kids on stage and they sang a song for us before we started one of our boring sessions. So thank you, and thank you for your ministry. We honor you. Well, last fall, Pastor Allen invited me to participate in a pastor's Bible study, which meets on Tuesday morning at 8:30 at Downtown Perk. And I discovered when I showed up the first time, it was around the 1st of October, that I was the senior member of that group. But what a group it is. And my spirit and my soul and my mind are so nurtured by that weekly gathering. I want to just say thank you to Pastor Allen and to all the pastors that put up with this old guy every week. So I told a friend of mine up at Lakeside when we were there in June that I was the geezer representative at the Bible study. And he said, oh, I have a sign for you. So I don't have to pull this out because I never feel disrespected, but just in case, I have this wonderful sign that said, respect the geezer. But one of the things that I learn at that Bible study is the pastors with whom I associate take God's word seriously, but sometimes, when people come in the back room at Downtown Perk and hear this group of anywhere from 6 to sometimes 8 to sometimes 10, Karen, our colleague, is one of those, they probably wonder what's going on because we are laughing our heads off. And we do everything from the deep study of Scripture to sharing what it is to be like in ministry in 2022. And what I need to say to anybody that ever gets impatient with the pastor, the church of 2022 is different from the church in which I was ordained in 1970. Our culture has changed, our standards have changed. The place of the church in the culture has changed. The role of the pastor in the community has changed. So for Vicar Derek, for Pastor Kyle at Christ Church, for Pastor Lindsay down in Belleville, for Pastor Jenny at Nankin and Paradise Hill, and for all these people you know and care about, and that I know and care about, this is a different church. So we need to cut our pastors a little slack right now, because they're learning how to do it all over again. COVID didn't help. What was already a decline was catastrophic in the life of the church. And I hear this every church I preach in. The people just didn't come back. Well, you see, they were already drifting away. And you and I know the number of saints who have left us to go to their next life. We haven't replaced them. We have not actively replaced the people who have died. You know, when Paul wrote to Timothy, it was such a different situation. It wasn't in a church that's declining, and I want to reassure every church that I have the opportunity to say this to, it's not just us. This is true across the board in every Christian church in the country. It's not something we're doing wrong. We just need to do it better. We just need to take who we are and what our strengths are and do it better. And Vicar Derek is here to help guide you through that. At Christ Church, Pastor Kyle is there to help guide that congregation through us. Jenny, who we adore at this church, has two churches, and she's trying to help them do that. And Pastor Lindsay, who gifted this church in so many ways, is trying to do that where she is. So when Paul wrote to Timothy 2,000 years ago, he was writing to somebody who was a disciple of his in some ways, but more a disciple of Jesus Christ, who Paul was trying to help guide. You know, these epistles, 1st and 2nd Timothy, are called the pastoral epistles. And they're named that because Paul is in his most pastoral sense of caring for Timothy and trying to instruct him. You know, as a former seminary teacher as well as a pastor, one of the joys of my life is to see ministers where they are, the ones that I knew as students, and where they are, and what God has done with their lives, and the way they're touching more lives. You know, it's the old image of dropping a pebble in a pond and watching the waves spread out from that. One of my former students was Maggie Estrino, Vicar Derek's spouse. She was a student of mine 12 years ago, and I still remember her final paper and presentation in the class she took for me. That's the kind of stunning student that she was. And now she's working for Life Bank and helping with people's lives as they come to a close. That's what Paul was trusting in Timothy. And here is Paul writing. He says, I'm in chains. He was a prisoner at that time, writing these letters to Timothy. But the word of God isn't chained. And even I, and Paul would never be too modest to say this, one of the foremost apostles of Jesus, if I'm in chains, the word that I'm passing on to you and that you are passing on to others is not. That word will never be changed, chained. It will not be confined. It will not be stifled in any way. And I'm trusting you with this. You know, one of the things I love about reading this is sometimes it's just practical advice. You know, he's saying some people are faithless. We have to live with that. But God is faithful. And if their lives are turned around in some way, they will be faithful again. And then I love this part of the passage that Justin read to us this morning, where he said, avoid useless arguments. My goodness, the world is at our doorstep. and we argue about the color of the carpet. Forget that stuff. Let's not waste our time on trivia. I don't know how many of you have ever had the chance to hear our Bishop Tracy Malone in the East Ohio Conference, but one of the things that Bishop Tracy Malone says to us repeatedly is, in the church, we need to keep the main thing the main thing. And the main thing that Paul was entrusting to Timothy, and Timothy passed on, and the saints who have lived across the ages have passed on to us, is that God is faithful. And even when the pews aren't filled, and when for a few weeks we have to listen to piano music instead of organ music, and for all the things that we see as shortcomings and limitations, the Spirit of God is not chained. It is passed on, and it's passed on to you and to me. So the question is, what are we going to do with it? And how are we going to handle that? When we were discussing in our pastor's Bible study the gospel lesson for this week, one of the things that another cherished colleague of mine, Pastor Karen Liddy at Peace Lutheran Church — I preach at Peace Lutheran a couple of times, you know — about 15 years ago, the Methodists and the Lutherans came to an agreement about celebrating communion with one another. So I can actually celebrate communion at Peace Lutheran Church without the Lutherans having to pray a prayer of decontamination afterwards. It's really quite lovely. But Pastor Karen Liddy pointed out in this lesson, sometimes we get what we want, we do what we're supposed to do. You know, and in this wonderful lesson from Luke — and Luke is such a great storyteller, it's very spare, but we have a lot of information in this — he says, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. Well, there is no region in between, it's a border. So he was somewhere along the border between the two. As he entered the village, 10 lepers approached him. They kept their distance. This is what lepers did. They lived in colonies separated from society because of their heinous disease. But they called out to Jesus. That's the only way they could approach somebody. They'd have to holler to them from a distance because they weren't allowed to be close because of their leprosy. Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Which says to us in some way that Jesus' reputation must have preceded him. They knew that they could avail themselves of his healing and strengthening touch. He said, when he saw them, go and show yourselves to the priest. This was a law that was passed down all the way from Mosaic law, 1,200 years before in Jewish history. They were doing what had to be done, and they did. But this is so interesting because they weren't healed on the spot. They were healed while they were on their way. I love that phrase. I just love that phrase. So many times you and I sit and wait for something to happen, and it doesn't happen. And then we go on our way, and what we sat around waiting for back there happens to us on the way. This happens to us all the way through our lives. I'm going to wait until I get a good job. Well, I had to get a job somewhere. And maybe in that job that I had to get somewhere, I fell in love with that job and found my true vocation. That's what I love about this story. They didn't sit around and wait for something to happen, and Jesus didn't allow that to happen. He said, go, do what you're supposed to do. Show the priests that you are cleaned, and they were cleaned on the way. But one comes back. One comes back. Can I tell you a little story about the song that was sung to us this morning? Sue, God bless you. I sang that song of what I knew of it over the phone to her. and said, I would really like that song to be sung that day. And she found it and transcribed it and arranged it. So thank you for our Trinity of Music over there. Pastor Karen Liddy pointed out to us in the study that while the nine lepers did what they were supposed to do, and I'm grateful to Karen for this insight because it informs so much of life, she said the 10th one did the better. The 10th one did the better. I am grateful to live in a community of Ashland, Ohio. Sometimes I'm not very politically at home here, truth be told. But I'm grateful to live in a community that lives a standard of generosity that I have seen few other places in my lifetime. I worked with the Ashland Symphony, and for 2 years I was a chief fundraiser, which I had never done before. And it was my duty to sign letters of thank you to people for their support. You know, and I would sign a dozen letters, sit at the dining room table and sign letters and fold them and put them in the envelope. And I'd say to Kitty, there is $3,000 in these 12 letters. And one time I signed a letter, and it was for somebody that said, I want to give $5,000 a year for 3 years. I thought it was going to fall off my chair. But we see this happening all around. Businesses that started in Ashland during COVID and are still working. And places like the new center, the daycare center, which is opening in the industrial area, giving people jobs is doing what's supposed to be done. Providing daycare is doing the better. Coming to church on Sunday morning and hearing the gospel, it's what we need to do. But when we go out and act on that, that's doing the better. That's who we're called to be. You know, and Jesus always has a hook. You know, a few years ago, I don't know how many of you remember Bishop Edwin Bolton. He was a bishop of our East Ohio Conference back in the 80s and 90s. And one of the fun things every year, a friend of mine and I ran a retreat at Camp Wanake for new ministers that just came into the conference. And it was just great fun. It was out in the campsite. And the highlight of these years that we did that was Bishop Bolton would come, stricken with polio and its after effects, walking on his two metal braces, and he'd have on jeans and a flannel shirt. Not very often you see a bishop in jeans and flannel shirt. And we'd sit by the fireplace in the downstairs of the meeting hall, and he'd sit in a rocking chair, and he would open the Bible and just start teaching. He was reading this story, and he said, and the hook in this is, the thankful one was a foreigner, a Samaritan, somebody that was on the outs with Judaism, somebody that didn't belong, and that was the one. There's always a hook in Jesus' story. And then Bishop Bolton, our dignified bishop of the East Ohio Conference, slammed his Bible shut and said, don't you just love Jesus? He was loose as a goose. I've never heard a bishop say that since. But he was right. Jesus is saying, we do what we're supposed to do. But he was saying, look, even this outsider did what was better. When I was about 11 or 12 years old, your age, Justin, my uncle gave me a little New Testament. It was about this big. And the print was tiny, tiny, tiny. And over the years and multiple moves, I don't know what's happened to that. But I do remember what he wrote inside the cover. I was 11 or 12, so it said, "To Tommy." And he wrote in there, 2 Timothy 2:15. Now, in King James language, it sounds like this: "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." So I had to look up what it meant to divide the word of truth. But it means what you said and what you read to us, rightly explaining the word of truth. Now, I'm not sure if that's where the seed for ministry was planted or not. I came to the realization by the time I was 17 that this is what God wanted me to do with my life. But that phrase is for all of us. Be a workman for God. Be a healer. Be a doer. Be a giver. Be one who operates out of this full sense of gratitude. Be one who is not ashamed, but rightly explains by our speaking, by our living, by the ways we help heal, by the good word, by the generous gift, that you and I will be rightly explaining that eternal, healing, strengthening word of truth.
Please stand.
Wonderful. Will the ushers please come forward? I've had to hold it up, and I wouldn't change a thing of it because my mother made my robe. Let us pray together. Dear Lord, Father, Abba, we just praise your name. You are a God who is ever present, God who is all knowing, God who is all forgiving, and God who loves each one of us unconditionally, even as we sin. We just praise your name loud and clear so the world may hear us. Dear Lord, so often we take you for granted. We take for granted that you will answer our prayers, that you will heal us and make us whole. We take for granted that you love us, forgive us for not appreciating your grace and presence in our lives. Help us to be more thankful. Give us faith to see you in everything and everyone around us so that we may be truly grateful. And Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the joyful ride into church today with the glorious blue skies and the changing of the color. We thank you that we could come not fearing persecution at all, that we can freely worship you, Lord. We thank you for those who contributed this service, for Tom and his great message, for Justin taking that first step, and believe me, Lord, we know it's scary, for Ryan and Carolyn Grace and Sue for the wonderful music. We thank you for the very privilege, knowing that we are wealthy in the eyes of the world because we have been given so much. And now, Lord, we pray that we may use that resources to serve you, that we may be your feet, your hands, and your voice to the world, that we may reach out to others, Lord, and give of ourselves. Lord, we pray for those right now in our congregation that need you in healing, for Ellen Moore, for Roy and Faye Turk as they need support, Lord, for Janet Durr. We pray for Donna Weaver's surgery next week, that you will bless those doctors and give them great wisdom and great skill and great healing for Donna. We pray for Linda, that she will be healed, Lord, and that they'll have great wisdom in what steps to take. We pray, thank you, Lord, for Mary for being here with us today, and pray is your name for the doctors to help her take that step back to us. We pray for Asher, Lord, and for healing and strength for him. Lord, we just thank you for all that you've given. Now, Lord, together we will pray the very prayer that you gave us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand for our next hymn, number 670. Thank you.
Go forth for God, go to the world in peace. Be of good courage, armed with heavenly grace. In God's good spirit, daily to increase. Till in the kingdom we see face to face. Go forth for God, go to the world in peace. Go forth for God, go to the world in love. Strengthen the faint, give courage to the weak. Help the afflicted richly from above. God's love supplies the grace and power we seek. Go forth for God, go to the world in love.
Go forth for God, go to the world in strength. Hold fast the good, be urgent for the right. Render to
go forth for God, go to the world in joy, to serve God's people every day and hour, and serving Christ our every gift employ, rejoicing
benediction. Jesus said to the leper, "Get up and get on your way. Your faith has made you well." Let us all claim Jesus' healing and liberation in our lives. Get up and go on your way in Jesus' name. Your faith has made you whole. And all God's people said, Amen. Please be seated for the health post, Lou. Thank you.